life is marching on. A narrative and a photographic biography of Bishop Garfield Thomas Haywood. He was gone from our midst. No crevice of time could remove the impact of his good works and deeds instituted by his expounding on the Word of God and his consciousness of there being an Almighty God who rules us all. Bishop Haywood was a man of renown. He was a poet, and one of the poems that sticks in my mind in this particular setting is, out from his bosom, burning and hot, drifting with fever straight to the spot, God breathed inspiration, deep striking the heart, his soul and his message, every atom takes part. Every fiber assisting in giving reproof, like hailstones pelting down hard on the roof, burning and shining, blood hot and bright, consuming the chaff, illuminating the night. Nothing in secret uncovered remain, till mean men promise from sin to refrain. Soul is delivered, sin and disgrace, vanishing leaves, no blot to retrace. Praise mingled, weeping of mother and son, enacting the proof of the good that's done. Fearless expounders of God's holy writ, alone makes mortal more heavenly fit. Seek not the office of pulpit control. Lest God blame you for some misguided soul. Words that were penned by Bishop G.T. Haywood, a man of renown. And we, realizing that there are many folk who are not aware of who the man is, many of you that are in the religious world are not knowledgeable of who the man is. And we felt that it was necessary to put together this little program to expound to you who Garfield Thomas Haywood is. Our guest at this particular time is a man of renown that we feel that is qualified to bring us this information and to try to give us that knowledge of who this great man was. And in the person of Bishop Ross P. Paddock, and we're going to switch over to him, and we're going to ask Bishop Paddock if he would take this time for this hour to expound to you who Garfield Thomas Haywood was and the role he played in the religious world. Bishop Paddock, the microphone is yours.
The man that we knew as Bishop G.T. Haywood, one of the greatest, one who received the greatest revelation of any other man in these last days. But for us to understand Bishop Haywood, we need to have the background to bring us up to his day to understand how he came to be what he was. He is the man that inspired my ministry, became my mentor more than 61 years ago. It was very unfortunate for me that he only lived 2 years after I started my ministry. So my personal contact with him was not nearly what I would like to have had it be. But I took the writings of this great man of God and studied day and night, many times sitting up all night long, taking his writings and comparing them with the Bible. Now, in the book of James, I would just like to read a verse. Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and hath long patience for it, until he receive the early and the latter rain. The outpouring of the Spirit of God is referred to in the Bible as the rain. It is to fall in two distinct and different periods. Just as in Israel's day, at the time of the planting of their crops, they had the former rain preparing the ground for the planting. And then throughout the growing season, there were sprinkles now and then, but no great fall as the early rain was. Then came the time for the reaping, and the latter rains came to ripen the grain and prepare it for the harvest. And that was what God has used to illustrate the church dispensation, the pouring out of the Spirit of God in what is called the former and the latter rain. The former rain began at the day of Pentecost, 50 days after Jesus rose from the dead. It continued to the life of the apostles. And when the last of the apostles died, which was John, somewhere between 96 and 100 AD, the latter rain tapered off rather sharply after that. And there was the long dry season, the growing season, we might say, in which there were little showers here and there, but no real outpouring of rain as had been in the former rain. It came down then until the time of the latter rain period, and as it approached, God began to deal with the hearts of people, and many of the people in the church world began to see holiness in the Bible and began to preach holiness. Now, they did not have holiness because there is no holiness outside the baptism of the Holy Ghost, but they lived godly lives, were very, very strict. It was a sort of a Victorian age. And as this age began to draw to a close, right toward the end of the last century, the rain sprinkles began to fall once again, and across the ocean in about three countries over there, there were a few people being filled with the Holy Ghost. No one in the United States, so far as we have any records, received the baptism of the Holy Ghost at that particular time. But in the year of 1900, a man by the name of Charles Parham established a school in Topeka, Kansas, just in the outskirts, in a building that was called Stone's Folly. A man by the name of Stone had built, started this mansion, and ran out of money and never did complete it. Just how Elder Parham obtained the use of that building for a school, we do not know. But at any rate, in the last end of the first year of this century, in 1900, in Christmas, between Christmas and New Year's week, Elder Parham had to go on a trip, and he assigned to his class a subject for their study. And the subject that he assigned was, what is the initial evidence of the baptism of the Holy Ghost? Now, he returned from his trip on the last day of the year. That was 1900, and on December 31st. He called the class together and asked them what had they concluded. And they said from their studies of the scriptures, they found that when one received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the first and initial evidence was they spoke in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave them utterance. And Elder Parham said, that is exactly what I thought. This being New Year's Eve, they had a watch service that night. And as they were praying and tarrying around the altar in the night, toward morning, suddenly a young woman by the name of Gladys Osmond began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave utterance. And this really stirred up the rest of the group, and they continued and on through the day, which is now the first day of January in 1901. A number different ones of the students had received the Holy Ghost by the close of that first day. This was the start in the United States. Now, as they spread out over the state of Kansas, preaching this message, it is a little bit unusual for us to think that Elder Parham himself did not have it as yet. And it wasn't until a few weeks later when he received the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave utterance. But as they spread out over the state of Kansas, there was great persecution. They suffered many things. It was common for them to be tarred and feathered and set on rails and ridden out of town and told not to return, and if they would return, they would be killed. Some way or other, they seemed to have jumped over the panhandle of Oklahoma and went down into Texas. And in this small town of Orchard, Texas, they had the first great revival down there, and people were being filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, Elder Parham's health was becoming very poor, and because of the hard winters in the state of Kansas, he moved his school down to Houston, Texas. And while they're teaching in Houston, a man by the name of William J. Seymour, and this was a black man, Elder Parham was a white man. Elder Seymour was a man who through some kind of injury had lost the sight of one eye. And he, coming from the state of Louisiana, a godly man and all that he knew, hearing of the school, he moved to the school in Houston and was trained there in the subject of the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. Now, again, it's a little strange. He didn't have it himself, but he began to preach it, and as an evangelist, his meetings were very successful, and people were being filled with the Holy Ghost, and the news of his meetings spread over the country. There was a woman, a pastor of a Nazarene church in Los Angeles, hearing of the success of his meetings and not knowing that he was preaching the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. She sent for him to come to Los Angeles to hold a meeting for her. And as he came, he preached on Sunday morning the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues as the Spirit of God gives utterance. When he came back for the night service, there was a padlock on the door. She refused to allow that doctrine to be preached in her church, and he didn't know what to do. He had no way to get back home, didn't have any money, he had no place to sleep, he had nothing to eat, and no way to go. And as he was walking down the street crying and praying, a white man by the name of Philip Ashbury asked him what was the problem, and he explained to him what had happened and what his situation was. And this man, and Philip Ashbury took him into his home on Bonnie Bray Street and gave him a sleeping room, fed him at his table, and allowed him to use the living room for services. And people began to come in, and the people began to be filled with the Holy Ghost. And when people are filled with the Holy Ghost, they like to shout. In fact, as it happened on the day of Pentecost, there was such a commotion that some of the people said, "These men are drunk. They're filled with new wine." And they shouted in the house in Bonnie Bray until the foundation of the house began to collapse, and they had to move out. They searched around, and they found an abandoned Methodist church that had more recently been used for a livery stable. And they cleaned up a portion of it and set up some nail kegs and laid some planks over the top. These were their pews, and began to have service there. And immediately, people began to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, we must go back to one of the old prophets that said that he would give them the former rain moderately. And if the former rain was to be moderate, then the latter rain certainly must be something more than moderate. Well, in the former rain, from the time of the day of Pentecost up to the time when Stephen was stoned, there may have been, and I'm just picking a figure out of the air, something like 10,000 people filled with the Holy Ghost. But when the Azusa Street Mission started, in 3 years' time, the revival continued for 3 years. And in that time, there were tens of thousands of people filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, they knew only the Catholic doctrine of the Trinity, and they continued as Trinitarians for a period of time. But all of these people being filled with the Holy Ghost, this could well have been just a local revival. But one of the ones who received the Holy Ghost early in this period of time was a man with the name of Frank Bartleman, and he was a religious journalist, and he published articles in the religious papers of every denomination throughout the country and even across the ocean. And he published the happenings of the Azusa Street meeting mission in all of these papers. As a result, big churchmen from every state in the Union and even some from across the ocean converged on the city of Los Angeles. And many of them said, "This is not of God, this is of the devil," and went back home and warned their people against it. They were fighting the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and they continued to do that until God stopped them. And the way he stopped them was, in the late 50s it began, and into the 60s, God began to pour out the Holy Ghost right in the nominal church world. And there is hardly a denomination in the world today that does not have some people that have the baptism of the Holy Ghost speaking in tongues. And we have called it the charismatic movement. And great numbers of them now have been filled with the Holy Ghost. The only problem is they do not recognize that God had a church here on earth, and so they did not come to the church to be taught the truth. They stay and are self-taught, and because they are self-taught, they only get a small amount of truth. But at any rate, there are great numbers all over the country that have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Now, in this early day, they continued in the Catholic doctrine of the Trinity, and their baptism, of course, was then applied in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. This was the formula that was used. But as they continued, now, began in the month of April in 1960. In the Azusa Street Mission, this was the real beginning of the latter rain. Up to this time, there had just been the little sprinkles here and there. But now the rain was really poured out, and people by the thousands were filled with the Holy Ghost in this mission. And in the year of 1913, God began to open their minds and their understanding and let them see the fullness of the Godhead was in Jesus Christ, that he was the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, and that these were not different persons, but different offices that the one God fulfilled. And so they, God began to let them see, and they began then to realize that the baptism was to be in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, as was preached by Peter on the day of Pentecost, and was practiced by the apostles throughout the time of the early rain. So they began to baptize in Jesus' name. This caused a great conflict because some of the brethren accepted it and some of them did not. Now the first two that were baptized in Jesus' name was Glenn A. Cook and Frank J. Ewart, both of California, of Los Angeles, and they had no one to baptize them, so they baptized each other. And then after they had been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, they could baptize others. And this is how the baptism in Jesus' name started. But many of the brethren refused to accept this new doctrine. They called it the new issue. Actually, this was not the new issue. They had the new issue because their doctrine never became official church doctrine until the Nicene Council in 325 AD. But the baptism in Jesus' name and the oneness of the Godhead began on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after Jesus rose from the dead. And so, after contending about it for approximately 1 year, in the year of 1914, the brethren that refused to accept the new light pulled out and made the first split, and they set up then their own organizations. Now, we must mention the fact that up to this time, the group was an integrated group. All nations, races, it made no difference. There was just the one body. But when these brethren separated from the original body, and we must say that the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World was founded in 1906 out of the Azusa Street Mission, had their first annual business meeting in 1907, remembering, of course, that they were still tied to the Trinitarian doctrine. But in 1913, the change began to take place. When the brethren separated in 1914, they at the same time segregated and established the Church of God in Christ among the blacks and the Assemblies of God among the whites. This was the first segregation among those that had been filled with the Holy Ghost. Now we have to back up for just a little bit, because in the year of 1908, a man by the name of Garfield Thomas Haywood received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues as the Spirit of God gives utterance. He was a very godly man, belonging to one of the denominations, one of the nominal churches. But when he received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, immediately he felt the call and the urge to preach this message. And before a few months had passed by, when he was still in his first year, a man who had a storefront church in the city of Indianapolis, I believe his name was Prentice, he brought Elder Haywood to him to become his assistant pastor. By the time Elder Haywood had the Holy Ghost for 1 year, this would be now in 1909, Elder Prentice left the city of Indianapolis and turned the church over to Elder Haywood. And from 1909 to 1915, he had built a congregation of 465 people. They had had a number of meeting places, once in a tin shop. Eventually, they ended up on 11th and Senate Street. A building there that had been formerly used for other purposes. And because this was on Senate Avenue, when they later on built their church on Fall Creek Boulevard, those that moved there were called the Senators. There may be a very few of them left living today, and those that are still living today, they still call the Senators, having come from Senate Street. However, in 1915, Elder Glenn Cook came from Los Angeles to Indianapolis, Indiana, to the old original church, which was Oak Hill Tabernacle, and there conducted a meeting preaching the oneness of the Godhead in Jesus Christ and baptism in Jesus' name for the remission of sins. Now, Elder Haywood had known him from the past, and so he went over to his service. But when he got there, he did not believe the message as he heard it. But he went back home, and a little bit later, as he was reading in the scriptures, he read these words: Jesus spake these words and went and hid himself. Now, I'm unable to determine how that could have done it, but it opened Bishop Haywood's eyes, and he said, Lord, you'll never hide yourself from me. He went right back and was baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of his sins. He then, in turn, baptized his 465-member church over again in the name of Jesus Christ and for the remission of their sins. It was only a very short period of time until he emerged as the one of the greatest of the pioneers of this oneness message. And the brethren as a whole throughout the country acknowledged him as the greatest of the pioneers of this oneness movement. Now, the Trinitarians, they also acknowledged him as the greatest of the pioneers, and it's rather amusing, but this is the manner in which they acknowledged him. there is in the third chapter of 1 Corinthians, a verse said, now if any man build on this foundation gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble. They took this scripture and they said, we, that is we who are still holding to the doctrine of the Trinity, we are building with gold and silver and precious stones. Now, every man's work was to be tried by fire, and these three would stand the fire test. But the other, wood, hay, stubble, are very combustible materials that would easily burn up. So they said, we are building with gold, silver, and precious stones. But they, that is those who have adopted this oneness doctrine, they are building, and if you will notice, they turned two words around to get the name. They said they are building on Haywood and stubble. This was their way of acknowledging that Haywood was the greatest of the pioneers of this oneness message back in that day. Now, in 1914, when they split from the P.A.W. and set up their own organizations, in 1915 then, the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World was reorganized as a oneness organization and has continued as a oneness organization till this day. We were called Pentecostals back in that day. But because the Trinitarians also called themselves Pentecostals, the oneness people took the title of Jesus Only. And it wasn't long until there was so much problem arose because of this, because they said that Jesus Only, you are denying the Father. And so the term of apostolics was adopted because it was the apostolic doctrine of the oneness and the baptism in Jesus' name that had now come to fruition in this group. So now they are now a oneness group and are now called the Apostolic Pentecostal people. And Bishop Haywood, though they did not call them bishop yet at that time, he soon emerged as one of the great ones, and in the year of 1918, he was elected as the General Secretary of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. Now, the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World had had two heads before 1925. And both of them were white men. The first one was Elder J.J. Frazee. The second one was Elder E.W. Doak. They did not call them bishops, they called them superintendents. But in the year of 1925, they assumed the title of bishop. And a board of seven bishops was to be elected, and one of them then was to become the presiding bishop. However, at that time, they only elected five, and it was 3 years later before they got the other two to make up the seven for the original board. But of the five that were elected, Bishop G.T. Haywood was the man that was elected as the first presiding bishop. And he served for 7 years until his demise. Now, the first two that had served, each of them served for 7 years. Then, when Bishop Haywood died, the brethren determined at that time to keep the office of presiding bishop vacant for 1 year in honor of Bishop Haywood. During that period of time, there was an attempted merger of the Apostolic Churches of Jesus Christ and the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. Now, both bodies sent to the other's organizational meeting the terms under which they would merge, and both bodies voted down those terms. Yet, because a number of the leaders of both bodies still felt it was the thing to do, they met in St. Louis later in that year of 1931 and concluded a merger. Consummated a merger. Now, we have to acknowledge that it was an unlawful merger because both bodies had voted it down. But this was not considered at that time. Both then, the AC of JC and the PAFW were supposed to be dissolved. However, the PAFW, we had a bishop by the name of Bishop A. William Lewis, and another bishop in California, And his name was Bishop F.I. Douglas, but because of his ill health, he just didn't travel. So Bishop Lewis traveled and got a few of the brethren together. He got the charter. Somebody had stolen the charter, but he found the charter and got it back and got a few of the brethren together. They authorized him to choose a man to assist him in holding the organization together, to travel with him, bring back as many as they could. And so he chose a young man who was comparatively unknown at that time, because almost all of his ministry had been in the country of Africa, and he had just recently returned. His name was Samuel Grimes. Now, in 1932, they then met in the city of Dayton, Ohio, and they elected then Bishop Samuel Grimes as a bishop. Now, at this time, Bishop Lewis's health broke, and for 10 years he was unable to preach a sermon. So that took him out of the picture, and Bishop Grimes became the top man. And as the presiding bishop, he served then for 35 years. The last 14 of those years, they had created the office of assistant presiding bishop. And I was elected as the assistant presiding bishop and continued to be re-elected and served for those 14 years. So at the end of his life, when his term finally expired, he had served for 35 years. I then became the presiding bishop, and in the meantime, we had passed a law that no presiding bishop could serve more than two terms, and the term by this time had been cut from 4 years to 3 years. So I got the 1 year of the unexpired term of his term and my two terms, so I've served for 7 years. So of the first five heads of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, four of us served 7 years, and Bishop Grimes served for 35. Now, we may go back now to Bishop Haywood. Bishop Haywood was recognized as the greatest, as we have stated, of the pioneers of the Oneness Movement. He traveled throughout the country, into Canada, down in the islands, and even as far as Jerusalem, and recognized worldwide as one of the greatest men. He was not only a great preacher and a teacher, and I have said this many times, he had the ability to take any subject and make it so plain that a child could understand it. And I have patterned my ministry after his, and that's what I have tried to do in my teaching as well. But at any rate, he was recognized as that greatest of all the teachers we have had in these last days. He did such a great job and was recognized and respected and honored. But the time came when, because of some jealousies that arose, some of the brethren began to turn against him. Now, he was taken sick. He had a meeting scheduled in Jamaica, but he was taken sick, but he would not cancel his meeting. He was that type of man. He never stopped for anything. Whatever his responsibility was, he fulfilled that responsibility. He went to Jamaica anyway, had the meeting down there, came back home, and took to his bed, and never did rise from his bed again. And the Lord took him home at the early age of 51 years. I feel very bad to realize at that early age he could have been here and could have helped us along the way, and we could have been far greater than we are today. But the Lord knows what he's doing, and he took him home. But he was not only a great preacher and a great teacher, but he also was a songwriter, and we still sing many of his songs yet today. Not only was he a songwriter, he was an artist. And he painted pictures. And in Christ Temple in Indianapolis today, the church that he built on Fall Creek Boulevard, the picture that he painted on the wall, two of them are still there today. Now, back after when they were ready to leave Senate Street, where they were called the senators, They went down to a place on Fall Creek Boulevard that had formerly been a city dump and had been filled in, and it is a very beautiful location. And there they he turned the first shovel of earth as they broke the ground and prayed and began to build. And he went to the banks to get money to build, and the banks told him they could not lend him the money until he had a certain amount of work done and a certain amount of money raised. But God blessed them, and they raised that money, and when the time came, they went to the bank, and the bank gave them the money, and they completed the job and built a very beautiful church there on Fall Creek Boulevard. It has since been remodeled outwardly, and other buildings have been added to it, but it is one of the landmarks in the city of Indianapolis today. And he was so well recognized that that portion of Fall Creek Boulevard has been renamed the Bishop G.T. Haywood Parkway. So we will recognize the fact that not only among the members of the church, but even among the people of the city and in the political area of the city, he was recognized as one of those great men of God in these last days. Now, Bishop Haywood inspired my ministry. I went to hear him, and I just couldn't believe, as I sat there in my seat, and I may as well tell you that my mouth came open and I couldn't get it closed. I was just drinking it in. He was such a remarkable speaker, and you simply had to know he was telling the truth. And he built a great congregation there in the city of Indianapolis. Now, the P.A.W., Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, in 1919 was incorporated in the city of Indianapolis under Indiana law. However, its headquarters was put in Portland, Oregon, and stayed there for approximately 4 years, and was then moved back to Indianapolis. And when they moved back to Indianapolis, they had no place for their headquarters office at that time, so a basement room in Christ Temple was turned over to the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World as their headquarters office, and it remained as the headquarters office until in later years when a office building was purchased on Illinois Street, and later on then was moved to the Meadows Plaza. But at any rate, he did everything he could for the P.A.W., and when he passed from the scene, one of his sons in the gospel, who had become pastor in Grand Rapids, Michigan, was called back home to take over the church. Now, his name was Robert Franklin Tobin, and he was the closest friend I ever had in this world. And every year, for a number of years, I preached for him, and he preached for me. In fact, he was the one that put me over nationally. I was well accepted throughout the state of Michigan, but was not nationally known, but it was Elder Tobin from Christ Temple, Bishop Haywood's church, that put me over nationally, because he brought me there the first time for 1 week's meeting. And the next year, he brought me back for 2 consecutive weeks. And when the news of this got out, I was in demand over the country. And that's how I've had my ministry throughout this country. I've ministered in every council in the United States, and all three of them down in the Caribbean. And there's only one reason this could be. And that reason, I must say, Bishop Haywood. Bishop Haywood inspired me, and Bishop Haywood became my mentor. I've tried to measure up in some degree to that which he set before me back in those early days. And oh, if we could only have kept him around with us for a few more years. But God knows what he's doing, and he called him home, and he is at rest. And one of these days, we're going to be caught up together with him to meet the Lord in the air. Now, what is holding back the rapture of the church? Only one thing. The husband waiteth and has long patience for it until he receive the former and the latter rain. The former rain was over back there in the first century, or very shortly after the first century was over. The latter rain began in the month of April in 1906 of this century. We are right up toward the end of that time now. But until that time, until he comes, we must occupy till he comes. We must continue to teach the truth of God that was given to us by the fathers back there. Now, I must go back again to the beginning, the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. When the Holy Ghost was poured out in the Azusa Street Mission, there were no fathers. The pouring out of the Holy Ghost is the fulfillment of the new birth. And the new birth consists of water and spirit. It takes the water baptism in Jesus' name for the remission of sins, and the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues as the Spirit gives utterance to make a birth. So all of those that were just filled with the Holy Ghost, there was no fathers to guide them. They were all just babes in Christ, and they made many errors along the way. But God began to give them revelation. And as he continued to reveal, now the first revelation was that the revelation of the oneness of the Godhead in Jesus Christ, consequently baptism in Jesus' name. And this is what caused the first split. Now after this, there were other doctrines, as we have said, they made many errors along the way. But God was continuing to give them revelation. That first one was in the year of 1913, which was the first of the teens of this century. And God continued then to give them great revelation through the remainder of the teens and throughout the 20s and into the very earliest part of the 30s. And this is the time when the Lord called Bishop Haywood home in 1931. But by this time, they had had such great revelation that the church had come full circle back to the full apostolic doctrine again, just as it was preached by the apostles beginning on the day of Pentecost back in the early rain period. And so we had the full revelation and the full doctrine of the apostles once again in the very early 30s. And my ministry began in the year of 29. So I only had those 2 years, but what he did for me in those 2 years is still staying with me until this day. Now, because of this, the revelation that was coming and different opinions by different ones, there were other splits came along. In the year of 1919, a man by the name of R.C. Lawson split, and he split from Bishop Haywood primarily, not necessarily so much from the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, though by splitting from Bishop Haywood, that took him out of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, and he established his own organization. And that is only one. There was then, in about the year of 1924, a group of Southern white brothers pulled out also and established their organization, which they called a Lily White Organization, and no man of color could be in it. Now they said that because of the racial problems in the South, that it was causing them too much problem to have a black man's name on their credential. I don't know how people would know that a man's name on a credential, whether that man was black or white, but that's the reasoning that they used. And this was then called the PCI, or Pentecostal Church Incorporated. Now, in 1931, then was the merger of that formed the Pentecostal Assemblies of Jesus Christ, and most of the PFW went into that body. Now, I myself came into that organization under the late Bishop S.N. Hancock of Detroit, who had formerly been the assistant pastor to Bishop Haywood in Christ Temple in Indianapolis. And Bishop Hancock was a presbyter in the PFJC. So naturally, I got my first papers in the PFJC, was ordained in the PFJC in the year of 1936 in the church pastored by Bishop Carl F. Smith in Columbus, Ohio. Now, after I was ordained, they came out in the open then with their stand. They did not believe in interracial worship, because they said, if you worship together, it's only a matter of time until there will be some interracial marriages. Well, the first interracial marriage on record was Moses the Jew married a black woman. He went down into the land of Midian, hired out to a black man to take care of his sheep, and for 40 years he was a shepherd boy there, and while there he married the boss's daughter and had two children. Now, later on, his brother and sister complained about that marriage, and God pronounced a great judgment upon them because of that. Now, I'm not going to go back into that judgment, but simply to let you know that the Bible said that in the church you may marry whomsoever you will, only in the Lord. There is nothing in the scriptures against interracial marriage. We realize that there are many people in this world that stand out against it, but it is not unlawful. It doesn't happen often, but it does happen, and it is not unlawful. But at any rate, this is what has caused some of the problems that we've had in the past. Now, in the year of 1939, the PCI, Pentecostal Church Incorporated, and the P.A.W, Pentecostal Assemblies of Jesus Christ, merged and formed what is known today as the United Pentecostal Church, the UPC, and they are numerically the largest of the oneness organizations today. But there have been five splits from the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, five only, since 1906. But the other organizations that were formed, they also split, and there have been, I have to say it like this, there have been splits, and then the splits have split, and then some of the splits have merged, and the mergers have split. Until today, there is somewhat in excess of 130 oneness organizations in the world today, all of them having received like precious faith as Peter expressed it. So there are more than 130 oneness organizations. I don't know how many, but I do know this, that back about 20 years ago, a group of the brethren, realizing that we must not be separated, we must be just one people, formed what was called the Apostolic World Christian Fellowship. Now, to become a member of this group, the parent body must sign a letter of intent of association. They came to the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World in our convention, and in 1972, the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World signed the letter of intent of association. I was at that time the presiding bishop. The board sent me then, along with my secretary, who is today our assistant presiding bishop, Paul A. Bowers of Cincinnati, Ohio, and we went to the meeting, and to our surprise, it was election year, and they elected me as the vice chairman. I have continued in that office until today. Now, we now have more than 120 of those oneness organizations signed up in our fellowship, and we're working on the rest. We are hoping that one day, before the Lord comes, we will have every one of the organizations signed up in our fellowship. This is not to bring them back into one organization. They stay in their own organizations, but we have fellowship. No longer is there any divisions among us. We have fellowship together and recognize one another, and this is what it's going to take, because when we are raptured or caught up to meet the Lord, we're going to have to be caught up together. And how can we be caught up together if we are not together? We have to get together down here. And in the book of Zephaniah, he said, gather my people together, yea, gather together. And then he lets you know when, just before the coming of the Lord. So this is an effort that has been put forth to bring into close fellowship and love and harmony and unity, all of the oneness brethren throughout the entire world today. And we are gaining ground rapidly there. I have not turned away from the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. I did retire from my diocese because of my age, being 83 years old, and having preached this message now for 61 years, it was just more than I could keep up with. But I still have three offices in our parent body, the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. I presided over the Northern District Council, which is the state of Michigan and a portion of Ontario, Canada, presided over them for 26 years. I retired from them, from that diocese 2 years ago. I still hold three offices in the Northern District Council. I still hold two offices in the Apostolic World Christian Fellowship. I'm still doing what I can and will be occupying until Jesus comes. I first have to say, I didn't come here to stay. I came to get ready to go. And that's what I'm doing now, getting ready to go. And I don't know how much time I have left here. Actually, that's none of my business. That's God's business. He's the one that called me. He's the one that gave me my life in the first place. And he's the one that put me here where I am. And I am so glad that he saved me when I was just a young man so that I could give God a lifetime of service. And after 61 years of preaching this message, and I must one time more repeat, it was put in me by the late Bishop G.T. Haywood more than 61 years ago. Now, many of the brethren over this period of time have varied in their doctrines, but I have not. I am still teaching the same thing that was put in me by Bishop Haywood 61 years ago. I have not diluted it. I am still teaching the same thing. Now, he was then became one of the fathers of the first generation of this latter reign period. I am of the second generation, and there are only six of us living yet today whose ministry goes back as far as mine. Two of them are retired. One is confined to his home because of illness, and one is confined to a nursing home, and only two of us left yet today that are active in the ministry, and that is Bishop William Smith of Los Angeles, California, and myself of Kalamazoo, Michigan. Now, we then are the last remains of the second generation. Now, the second generation would go a little bit beyond that, but the only six of us left who go back as far as my ministry does. So practically all of the second generation of fathers are now gone, and there are now the third and the fourth and the fifth generations of ministers in the world today. But now, of this second generation, the fathers of the first generation, they passed it on to us. And we read in the book of Deuteronomy that the secret things, and the Bible is written, is a mystery and is only understandable as it is revealed by the Holy Ghost to those that have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. In fact, he said, the natural man, that's the man that's not born again, receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they're foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, for they are spiritually discerned. So we have to understand that the natural man cannot understand the things of the Spirit or the spiritual things of God. They can understand the natural things of the Bible, but not the spiritual things. So we today are preaching and teaching these things, but there has been some variances of doctrines along the way. And so this has caused some problems, and perhaps that was one of the major reasons for the splitting and the various organizations that have been set up. But now, I am still teaching what the fathers put in me, what Bishop Haywood and those that were his contemporaries, whom I knew back there, great numbers of them from that first generation, and they passed it on to us. Now, as he said in the book of Deuteronomy then, the secret things belonging to the Lord our God. If then we will get them, we have to get them from him. But we have to get them his way, not our way. We can't demand that he do it our way. We've got to do it his way. So he said, and those things which are revealed, and that certainly indicates that some things have been revealed and some things have not yet been revealed. As long as we live, we'll still be learning. There'll still be things that we do not know. But at any rate, those things that are revealed belong unto us and to our children forever. He said, as that we may do all the words of this law. Well, that was the Mosaic law, and today we're under the royal law, as the New Testament tells us. But at any rate, these things that was revealed to the fathers back there, they were to pass them on to their children. They passed them on to my generation. Unfortunately, some of my generation did not receive all that they gave, and they only received what they wanted. And then out of the conceit of their own minds, they diluted that doctrine and passed on a diluted doctrine to the next generation, who in turn received only what they wanted and diluted it again and passed on next generation a twice diluted doctrine. And this has been the way it has been down until now. Until today, we are sorry to have to say that there is a great conglomeration of doctrine that's being preached by the apostolic Pentecostal brethren. But as long as we stick to the fundamentals, the foundation, and that is the oneness of the Godhead in Jesus Christ, baptism in Jesus' name for the remission of sins, the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues, which these two constitute the new birth, and then continue to strive for a life of holiness. We're heading in the right direction, and as long as we keep that fellowship together and have that love one for another, we will never see eye to eye 100% here in this world. There is no such thing as two identical persons in this world. Not even identical twins are completely identical. There's always some differences, and people that know them well can tell them apart. So it is in the spiritual as well. There will never be any two of us that see everything absolutely eye to eye as long as we have these carnal bodies and finite minds. But when the rapture takes place, we'll put off these carnal bodies and put off these finite minds, and we'll put on our celestial bodies that are made like unto to his glorious body, and then we will have the mind of Christ, and we will know even as we are known. So we are striving now right here in this very last day, looking for Jesus to come, hoping for him to come, and I was hoping he'd come before we finished this broadcast, but he has not come yet, and we will continue to strive until he does come. But I just want you to know, this is the background of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, and primarily then the great man that we have known and loved so much, and that was the late Bishop G.T. Haywood.